In our third video, we look at what has happened recently that makes it almost impossible to return to growing incomes for everybody. Around the year 2000, something important has changed in how we retrieve energy and natural resources. During the 20th century, we had found more and more deposits, and we got better and better at extracting them. But recently, almost all new discoveries of fossil energy and natural resources are of lower quality compared to the past. Two examples. Until about 15 years ago, most oil drilling took place on land or in shallow water. But since then, we expanded to deep sea fields as low as 20,000 feet below the surface and to cracking rock for oil. And not too long ago, copper ore grades were between 1 and 2%, which means that for every ton of copper, we moved and crushed 50 to 100 tons of rock. Today, the average copper ore grade is 0.65% globally and only 0.4% in the United States. For each ton of copper, we now need to handle 150 to 250 tons of raw material. The easiest way to comprehend the consequences is a farm. If the farmer and his family produce barely enough to feed themselves, they don't have much left to buy tools, seeds, and other life essentials. That is how most people lived before the Industrial Revolution, and how about 2 to 3 billion people still live today. Between 50 and 90% of their harvest was and is needed to keep family and farm animals alive. In today's industrial economies, only a small part of our effort goes into retrieving the energy and natural resources we need. The rest enables us to reap the benefits. We use them to build infrastructure or consume goods and services. Yet as soon as our planet demands more effort to fetch these ingredients, it becomes more difficult to maintain today's wealth and the economy begins to shrink. Already today, the world can only maintain its resource use with the help of cheaply borrowed money. And, as we have seen in our first video, only a few people are benefiting. If we want to expand the global economy from here, we need to grow our energy and resource consumption. Growing the world's output by 2% annually until the year 2050 translates to doubling gross world product from 2015. Using the recent past for guidance, doing so would also require doubling our natural resource consumption and growing our energy use by 90%. This means going after deposits far less attractive than the worst ones we use today, with even lesser benefits. There is no way we can afford that and not run out of credit. What happens if we introduce more renewable energy to that picture? Wouldn't cheaper and cheaper wind power, solar PV, and other renewables help growing again? As we know, this hasn't happened yet, and the why is easy to explain. Fossil fuels are like a fast food menu, ready to be eaten right away. They are high density, easy to transport and store, and we can burn them whenever we want. Solar energy and all its derivatives like wind and hydropower are low density energy sources. Using that meal example, it translates to growing all the ingredients, harvesting them, preparing them, and cooking ourselves. With coal, natural gas, or oil, we can heat our house during a cold winter night. If we want to use the sun for that purpose, we need to collect its energy, condense it, and store it. Because, except maybe for Death Valley, you can't even fry an egg just from exposing it to sunlight. But in Death Valley, the last thing you would want is a fried egg. Therefore, any economy built on renewable sunlight, like it was before the year 1800, will be much smaller than our current one using prehistoric sunlight. Just to be clear, this does not mean we shouldn't use renewable energy, but we need to accept that when doing so, there will be no growth, much like with the hard-to-get fossil fuels and resources. The unpleasant bottom line is, no matter how, our incomes will shrink. They are already shrinking for most people in advanced economies. Now the encouraging news. Happiness is not related to income above $8,000 to $10,000 per capita. once we're healthy, well-fed, protected from harm, and with access to education, more wealth adds nothing to our well-being. It simply adds resource consumption. So why is nobody recognizing this? Unfortunately, that's how we are wired. Throughout human history, it has always been safest to look at the recent past for guidance. For hunters and gatherers, taking the beaten path ensured a safe return. And apart from the past 250 years where everything happened at supersonic speeds thanks to stored fossil energy, there was rarely a need to change much, let alone quickly. With the 20th century's experience, it is inconceivable for most of us that economic growth could end. And it takes a conscious effort to look further into the past to understand how fast our future is changing. In our next video, we are going to explore how economic science ended up with a worldview that expects infinite growth on a finite planet. Please come back for more.